Hi guys, sorry there wasn't a vlog yesterday. I just had a fucking bad day, but hey, we all have that some day times, right? So this particular vlog is quite a special one. It's not only one of my taco clock vlogs, but also a video response to Awesome Paint Job. So he had a vlog or something, a video, Jesus Christ, on his channel about brushes, and there seems to be an issue with Kolinsky brushes being banned from US market, and there are probably different reasons like protecting wildlife, whatnot. And he asked for responses, what we think about brushes and what we use, and do we own Kolinskys, do we love them particularly, and blah blah blah. So here we go. All of you guys know that I do paint stuff with mixed media. I use acrylics and watercolors and pastels and different gels for media and whatnot on large canvases or just very tiny watercolor papers. So of course I need a couple of different brushes to accomplish things on paintings of any kind in my studio. So I just wanted to talk a bit about the tool for any painter, and that is of course his or her brush, like that one. Guess what, that's what my channel and my blog and everything is named after. It's called Pinselgeschichten, which means stories told with brushes. So these are my tool for working. If I would be a carpenter, I would have a hammer or whatnot, any other stuff that I don't know about. But I'm a painter, so of course I need my brushes. And there are very, very different ones that I like a lot. So first of all, Awesome Paint Job related, I grab whichever brush suits what I want to do. So I don't care about brands or hypes or whatnot. I don't give a flying fart in space what kind of brush it is and if it costs 15 bucks or 45. I don't care, as long as I can do with that brush what I want to accomplish. That's the only thing that is important to me. So there are, of course, a couple of things that I do prefer certain things over others. Like, for example, if I want to paint fur or grass or trees, something like that, or for different kinds of shadows, I do like a real brush, not the synthetic stuff that is out there on the market. I want to have real hair. So I do have quite a couple of different brushes, like for example this big round bitch here that is natural hair and that goes perfect for shading things or going for fur or trees, grass, other rough textures on a painting. And I only use this particular brush here for acrylics. I don't paint oils, by the way, just before you ask. So I don't know about oil stuff, I've never used that medium, so I just don't know. I have never taken any time to get educated on the oil painting stuff. So these kinds of brushes I like a lot. They fit into my hand, which is not the biggest hand, and they're just nice when you want to paint big surfaces. Also with that pointy tip here, a lot of things that you could do with this brush only instead of changing brushes like 1500 times in one painting just to get something done, like clean edges and shadows and texture. When you actually paint a cloud with this one, it will look real with pretty much no effort. It's just that the angle here helps a lot. So I really like this brush. I also have others like this particular one. It's a Da Vinci Kolinsky brush, one of those that we were talking about. And this is effing expensive in my country, I have to say. So I cherish it and only use it if I really want to accomplish something. Like, I use it more for watercolors than for acrylics, actually. This is perfect for any watering backgrounds or for clouds, heavens, smooth blending surfaces where you have dark and light, or maybe two or three colors that you want to blend together. Awesome thing here. You can see, you can't, like, speak clearly. You can't see any brush strokes in the end, and sometimes you want to accomplish that. So this is a very soft hair here, and real hair as well. So I really, really adore this one. I don't use it that often, but that's just because I don't paint watercolors, for example, in that humongous size very often. I do, but not very often. Then of course I do have, and now that's the response to you, awesome paint job, my Kolinskys here. I only own 5 of those, and they're of the smaller size. They are, let me see which one is the smallest, 3/0 up to 6. That's the sizes I have. So 3/0, this is 0 to 4 and 6. So that's the set that I own. And I actually got it for Christmas from my parents-in-law, because like I said, they're quite expensive here, but I really, really like them. I use them only for very thinned down acrylics, for watercolors, for inks. I really, really like how they behave. They're kind of like the perfect mixture between real hair and synthetic. So they're quite soft and snappy, but when you paint with them, they really get some texture on your paper or canvas, whatever you want to do. So I really like to use those. However, since I only own those smaller sizes, I don't use them on big canvases a lot. It's more like a 10 by 8 inches paper that I use them on, or also canvases, of course, even wood. I even use them on wood, but they have a certain quality that I like, but that I only use quite seldomly. There's other ways to work around if you don't want to spend the money, or if you can't afford these kinds of brushes. They are not the bread and butter for any painter, or anything that I know to paint and that I couldn't work a way around it. They make things easier, but they're not the a must-have, so to say. Though I really, really value those. I also do have quite a bunch of real synthetic brushes that this jar here I only use for watercolors. So these are distinct watercolors brushes, and I do have different sizes here. Also, I have a spatula to, well, take off some color, and also some colors shaper rubber thingy, and that comes in quite handy. I do have one of those bigger flat ones and one round one, because I'm the max size that I paint is DIN A4, which is let me think, that's 30 by I think 24 centimeters, which would go by something 10 inches by something 12 inches, I guess. So it's not the biggest surface that I paint on with watercolors, and I do just have different ones. Here they came in two sets, so I really like different shapes here. However, with watercolors I use this one, this angled one, quite a bit. Also the normal, that's a 1.5 size flat. I like those cat tongue shaped ones. I use both of those sizes a lot, and of course I use my rounds quite a bit, and that is size 6 and size 5/0. So I really like synthetics for watercolors and for a couple of acrylic paintings, but it really depends on what motif or topics I'm going to paint. Like for example, if I really go for a natural, realistic look of nature, synthetic will be nowhere in that painting. No, I really like real hair for anything that is real, natural occurring things in the world. I don't want to have any almost like manga or cartoonish looking, smooth looking things on a natural painting. That's not what the world looks like to me. So I only use real hair with these kind of paintings. However, if you want to go for portraits or whatever, synthetics are quite helpful, even with acrylics, even thicker acrylics, or acrylics together with certain gels. They work together fine, and you can use even a synthetic brush for those. In this jar here, I do have a collection of my mainly any gels, acrylics, even glue, like Mod Podge or whatever. I'm using those here, and they're a mixture of synthetic and real hair in all different sizes, and you see that my brushes are quite used, and here they are not too bendable. I put them into water before I paint with those. I had them in turpentine recently, so they're quite strong and well, not in the greatest shape yet, but I always put them for 5 minutes, I put them in the water and they behave perfectly with acrylics. And those are like almost 10 years old, so they are allowed to look like that, and I paint a lot with those. So this is, for example, size 30, this is a size 28 flat, real hair. I also have this little sucker here, give me the size, it's a size 4 of those fan brushes, and this is real hair. I think it's Kolinsky as well. Yeah, it is. Forgot to sort it out into the other jar. So this is one as well, and they are really, really cool for painting acrylics, like nature paintings, I have to say. Of course, I also have my synthetic cat tongue here, and they didn't behave too well with the turpentine cleaning, but with enough water, they are quite bendable as well. You can see only the top is bendable, but I had to deep clean them, and now they are just like really, really strong, but they get softer once you have them in water for like 5 minutes, and then you can use them as if they were new. I also have like, what is this? Plain air bristle, which is China bristle, pretty much, at least when you translate it. I really, really like those for more of the gels and They are okay for decoupage, for mod podges and whatnot, but they're also very cool for the final touches of something when you go with acrylics, like thinned down acrylics, watered down acrylics. They're this kind of bristle really helps a lot. I really like those. There's of course also the super tiny ones here that I have. This is a size, I don't know what, because there is a blob of color. It's a size 2. And this is a real synthetic. A real synthetic. So I guess for the smaller ones, like for the sizes around 0 or parts of 0, I guess I like synthetics more than real hair. But then again, there's only so many things that I paint in miniature size. I'm not working on any miniature figurines, so I'm just working on flat surfaces pretty much. So I don't know how those would behave with miniatures on plastic, maybe. I don't know. My husband, who does paint miniatures, uses completely different brushes, but he also has real hair and synthetic, so I guess the there's quite a bit of parallel reasons for why we use what on what miniature for or painting, so to say. So this is the last jar. This is also acrylics and Mod Podge whatnot, but these are the brushes that do not have a long handle. Like, see, there's a slight difference there. So I keep them in two different jars so that the shorter ones don't get lost in the bigger jar there. And this is pretty much the same thing. There's a mixture of synthetics and real hair. For example, this is Petit Gris Pour. Sounds like French, and it is. It's real hair. Also Da Vinci's. So I really like Da Vinci's, by the way. If you are in Germany or Europe, you probably know that brand if you're a painter. I really like those just because they are nicely shaped for my size of hands. And they are durable. I have some that are older than 10 years and they're still like, they behave as if they are brand new. So really like those. I also of course have the cheaper ones where the handle already falls apart, but the bristles are still fine, so I'm okay with that, and I managed to somehow hold on to those. Of course, a lot of natural hair brushes. Let me see if I find my oldest one. If it was in here, I think. There it is. That sucker. Okay, hold on. I just gotta put that stuff back. So, this is my oldest brush. This is... let me think back. I think it's 8 or 9, 10, 11, 12. No, that's acrylics. So, that's about 8 years old now. And you see, it looks really used, and it is used. Like, half of the brush hair is already fallen out. And this is a size, oh, if I could read that. I only see color blobs. I don't know what size it is. It doesn't say anymore. There's just like, as you can see, let's get the focus over here. This is all covered up with color. And this is, by the way, recently cleaned with turpentine as well. So this is as clean as it gets. Same here. This is a size 15 Da Vinci, and this has real hair, very long real hair, and you can see you can hardly bend it anymore. But this is perfect for moss and clouds and very many other things that occur in nature. That's why I keep those around. They look ugly and you can't really use them for anything else. But you can use them for that. You can use them for grass or clouds, anything that is not well, that is natural and that you looks unique, pretty much. There's no cloud like another, and there's no blob of grass like another, or a tree or whatever. They look similar, but they're never the same. So these old and raggedy looking kind of brushes, I like them a lot for these kinds of paintings, for that kind of work. Then I have those other specials, like this one here. This is actually a shaving brush, and this is, like, you can see it's real hair, and this goes perfectly for illustrations in art journals or whatever, where you just want to dab on, you just put some color on top, like very thin, and you just dab it onto a painting and make patterns there. This is a great tool for that. So of course I have one of those, and all of the others are more like specialty brushes where I use those to, well, base coat something or varnish something, like wooden boxes or whatever. Kind of huge, right? But natural hair as well. So I guess I have more natural hair than synthetics, I just realized. This one here is really difficult to bend. This is actually coming from the German equivalent of Home Depot. So this is, I use that a lot for wood or watering down stuff, like watering artist boards before I watercolor on them and stuff like that. So use those a lot. Also this one here, or I use them on cardboard, like for example the different parts that I made of the puzzle. It's on my channel, just check it out. There's somewhere there, I think 4 videos now, where I paint stuff on boxes, like delivery boxes, and make a puzzle in my studio, and that's actually above and behind me, but you can't see. Those kinds of brushes are perfect for that, because you don't need to have high quality brushes there that you can see every detail on once you're like half a millimeter or a centimeter away, I should say. Don't need that when you paint stuff for a wall that's 11 by 4 meters long. So the size of these kind of paintings that I paint is quite big, and I don't need to have a lot of detail there. It's more like almost like a clip art or cartoony kind of painting. Those brushes here, I like them a lot for that kind of painting, where I just throw on colors onto the cardboard. So I guess these are all my lovely brushes that I use for different kinds of artwork. Like I said, I don't care what brand they are from and how much they cost. I don't have to have the Ferrari or the Gucci of the brushes. I just need them to stay as good as they can for as long as they can. And what I really, really hate when brushes break down, like I do have a couple of brushes that are, the bristles are still okay, but again and again, that part here on the handle where it connects to the metal, the wood underneath gets wet at a certain point, and then time goes by and it loses its tightness, I'd say. So you have a perfectly good bristle and that metal thing looks okay too, but the handle goes flying somewhere like all the time. And then you put some really, really strong glue in there, and 2 weeks later again your brushes break down. I hate that. So whenever I do have something like that, and I'm trying 3 times to, with different kinds of very, very strong glue, to repair my brushes, if it doesn't work anymore, they are gone from my studio. Because I just can't afford getting aggressive and frustrated just because my brush breaks down for the 100th time in a month. So that's, there's no, it's just not worth it. Pretty much you ruin, you maybe ruin any painting that you're just working on just because the bristles fall everywhere, but they just don't stay in your hand on that lovely handle. So I really hate when that happens, and I value any brush from any brand from anywhere in the world that has a decent handle, good bristles that you can use for so many paintings, and that maybe get old and raggedy at one point, so that you can use those brushes for other purposes. That's totally fine by me. And all in all, I could repurpose real hair brushes more than synthetic brushes, just because synthetic brushes don't get to that raggedy state where you can use them for trees or bushes or moss or whatever in a painting. I never accomplished anything like that with a synthetic brush, no matter how old it was. I only did that with real hair brushes. So awesome game job coming back to your vlog and having this as a video response. I don't care, and I'm not pro or against banning Kolinsky brushes from any kind of state, like it being the US or Germany or Asia, Japan maybe, or China. I don't care. I'm okay with real hair brushes if the animals don't get hunted and shot for their bristles only. Like if it is a side product of something else, like for example, if you slaughter pigs to have food and some other thing like leather maybe, and you can also use the bristles for maybe painting brushes or other brushes, okay, go for it, use it, no harm done, no problem with that. I would have a problem with these kinds of brushes if you would hunt the animal only for that one purpose. If that would be the case, I would say go for synthetics and really work them down, ruin them to that state where you get the effect of a natural hair bristle on a painting, I'd say. So I hope you enjoyed watching this video and maybe got some ideas or just some other angle of thought about brushes and well, other possibilities that you have with this loaded market. If you have any questions, please let me know. I'm very happy to share my thoughts or, well, answer any questions that you might have. Other than that, I hope I see you tomorrow with a new Taco Clock vlog. And I hope you had a very good last 2 days and enjoyed and did create something maybe. So I will see you tomorrow with a new vlog. Take good care and have fun, I guess. Bye.